And I'm very delighted to welcome you back for the second day, and a special welcome to all of you who are joining online throughout the world. We're very pleased to have you with us. Yesterday, we heard some inspiring messages, as well as some cautionary messages as we reflect on 50 years since the Stockholm Declaration of 1972. Professor Jeff Sachs yesterday noted that in many respects, we have failed to change the trajectory, the self-destructive trajectory of our planet throughout the past 50 years, and that law has played frequently a negative role in working toward environmental conservation and sustainable development. But law also presents many great opportunities and is necessary in order to ensure an equitable transition toward a more sustainable future. We were pleased last evening to hear from Inger Andersen, the UNEP executive director, who spoke of how we might be able to turn toward a new and more inclusive multilateral approach to environmental protection. So I'm looking forward to our continued discussions today with so many distinguished speakers, high court judges from throughout the world, and many other experts who will be speaking to us about access to justice issues and other topics related to environmental law. So I'm pleased to turn to our first panel of the day, which will be on an official launch of the Global Judicial Environmental Portal, an important initiative of the Global Judicial Institute on the Environment, together with the UN Environment Program and other partners, to provide an opportunity for judges to exchange information and share and exchange experiences about environmental adjudication in order to promote disseminate information about access to justice and other environmental matters. So I'd like to call up here to the front Justice Antonio Arma Benjamin from the National High Court of Brazil and the president of the Global Judicial Institute on the Environment, and would also like to welcome other members of this panel who are joining us virtually on Zoom. Eva Duer, legal officer from the UN Environment Program, Judge Marc Clément from the Administrative Court of Lyon in France, and Peter Speelman, associate legal officer at the UN Environment Program. Please, Justice Benjamin.
And the chair.
Oh, and
we have two co-chairs.
Yes, and two co-chairs for our panel as well. Justice Luc Lavrysen, president of the Constitutional Court of Belgium and chair of the European Union Forum of Judges for the Environment, who is joining us online, and Donald Kaniaru, former director of the UN Environment Program Law Division as well. So please join us here at the front.
Good morning, Stockholm. Greetings.
And with that, I'll turn it over then to the chairs of our panel, Justice Lavrysen and Donald Kaniaru.
So good morning, Stockholm.
Oh, yes.
Greetings from Dakar, Senegal.
Please.
I'm attending here a conference of the Constitutional Court.
Good morning, everyone. Yes, I will just explain the gifts that you have been provided with. Unfortunately, you look, haven't got any. It's on the tables here in Stockholm. Unfortunately, the letter here, it's from Hanna Werth, who you met yesterday, the chairman of the Swedish Association for Judges, that has provided you with these small gifts. Unfortunately, due to the constraints of our post office, we haven't got the cheese slicer that is mentioned in the letter from her. But I hope you will accept these small gifts anyhow, and I hope you will continue to have a fruitful conference today. Thank you.
So thank you very, very much. So, as indicated by Nick Breiner, we will have this morning the official launch of the Global Judicial Environmental Portal. It's one of the, let's say, major projects of the Global Judicial Institute on the Environment. And I think we can say that just judges must be able to communicate with each other, to learn from each other, to have access to sources of environmental law, including jurisprudence, and because the environment is a worldwide issue, also jurisprudence from other parts of the world. And of course, these days, if we are looking to sharing information, having access to information, we have to look. We cannot others than to look to the internet and to ICT technologies. In this panel, we have four speakers. The first one is live, I understand, in Stockholm, is Justice Antonio Herman Benjamin, who is the chair of the Global Judicial Institute on the Environment. And of course, he took also the initiative for the development of this Global Judicial Environmental Portal. I think I do not need to present to you Justice Antonio Herman Benjamin, because I think yesterday was in nearly every panel, I think. The second and the third speakers are, in the first place, Eva Duer, and then Peter Speelman, both from INFORMEA. INFORMEA is the United Nations information portal on multilateral environmental agreements. And the judicial portal has been developed in close cooperation and with the support of INFORMEA. Eva Duer is a legal officer in the team and team leader of what's called the Collective Intelligence for Environmental Governance of UNEP. And Peter Speelman is the associate legal officer with the same unit. Furthermore, and maybe that can come as a surprise, there are also some, let's say, ICT nerds within the judiciary, including one of the judges who is in the panel, being Judge Marc, Clément, who is now a presiding judge with the Administrative Court of Lyon, but that's just one of his activities. He is a furthermore member of the Autorité Environnementale in France. He's also a member of the Aarhus Convention Compliance Committee, and he has been closely involved with the development of the portal. And I said he is an ICT nerd. He developed also different websites for different associations of judges, including the first website of the European Union Forum for of Judges for the Environment. So I will give now the floor to Justice Antonio Herman Benjamin, who is with you in Stockholm.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, for those that are in different time zones. I would like to begin thanking Hanna Wert, the president of the Association of Swedish Judges, for giving us not just a lovely gift, but a useful gift. I'm already using mine. So please, I ask Judge Bergson to convey to her that it was very appreciated the gift that we received. Let me thank the two co-chairs, and I'll be brief because we are more interested in knowing how our portal, the judicial portal of the Global Judicial Institute on the Environment in cooperation with UNEP looks and what it can offer and how we can add more to this. As Justice Luc Lavrysen mentioned, and I believe he is in Dakar, and that's why he is not able to be with us here today in person. The Global Judicial Institute on the Environment, even before it was formally started, the founding members, several of them are here, others are connected, wanted to build a judicial portal. So that was the first thing that came to all those that were involved in the preliminary discussions that led to the establishment of the Global Judicial Institute on the Environment in 2016. And it was decided that we would build a judicial portal by judges for judges, as I don't need to repeat that for us judges is very important that we preserve the independence of our work, and not just the way we see ourselves, but the way we are seen by others. Then I had the opportunity to meet Eva Duer, who is with us. And I already knew about the fantastic work that she and her colleagues were doing within the context of the MEAs and building a set of jurisprudence, but also connecting that jurisprudence with the specific MEAs. And also back many years before, IUCN, FAO, and UNEP established what was then called and still called ECOLEX, more on legislation and also embryonic jurisprudence. So we discussed among ourselves, among the judges, and we thought that why invent the wheel if we could work together with our natural partner, UNEP. So that's how it began. And many thanks to Eva and later on to Peter. Both of them will be speaking and presenting the extraordinary preliminary results, not the final portal, but this is the global launch. We have already launched regionally and more incomplete versions of the portal, but now the portal is operational with the exception of the part of the portal that is reserved for judges. Only judges will have access to that part, but I will not go into the technicalities because both Eva and Peter will explain that. From the Global Judicial Institute on the environment side, we asked two colleagues to take the lead in this collaborative work with UNEP, and they generously, kindly accepted the task. First, Justice Luc Lavrysen, and second, Judge Marc Clément. And they have both participated in technical discussions, virtually, in person. And I am on behalf of the judges of the Institute, very grateful to both of them. So I think that's, in a nutshell, a very brief introduction. I'm not going to use my 15 minutes. One last point, though. We judges depend on knowledge and information. But it's not just any knowledge or any information. It has to be good knowledge, both legal and non-legal, and information, both legal and non-legal. And as Justice Lavrysen has just stated, we also depend on communication among ourselves. And communication, or means of communications in which we feel that we are safe to discuss in a reserved manner among us about concrete cases that or difficulties that we are facing in our work as a judge. And the portal, as you are going to see, provides for that. The next step that we are working as we speak is to finalize an MOU with UNEP. We still, we couldn't do it before because the Institute was not registered in Geneva. Now it's fully registered and we can then proceed to a more formal approach to this rich and important collaboration. Mr. Chair, in fact, the two chairs, Donald Cuniaro and Luc Lavrysen, I stop here because I think everyone is much more interested on the portal itself than in on things that I could say as a non-expert. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Justice Antonio Herman Benjamin. Let's turn now directly to Eva and Peter to give us a glimpse of this judicial portal. So please, Eva, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Luc, and thank you so much, Justin Benjamin and Luc Lavrysen, for this introduction. Indeed, this is a very exciting day for us. We have been having this collaboration flourishing over the past years, and it is, of course, a big moment to have the judicial portal officially launched today. And as both justices have already indicated, and Justice Benjamin, you have initiated this whole process, we have been approached by the Global Judicial Institute first in 2018, and there were initial brainstorming discussions, and of course we were very excited about this development right away. Indeed, the Global Judicial Institute was welcomed as a partner to the INFORMEA initiative in 2018. And as you said, that was already an opportunity for UNEP to having piloted and tested a system that allows different knowledge sources to independently connect to each other and share each other's information. And of course, the MEAs who had increasingly developed interest in jurisprudence and how jurisprudence actually brings to the ground international law have been very enthusiastic about this collaboration. And so a first prototype was then developed already in August and presented. And from there were a lot of maturity issues and further development issues, a lot of discussions with Justice Clément, Justice Lavrysen, and in the end of the day, the first beta version was launched or was presented to the third General Assembly of the Global Judicial Institute on the 8th of December in 2021 at the height of the COVID situation, where it was very fitting to make this information accessible for the first time without much outreach. And as it has been mentioned, and I think this is very important from UNEP's side to mention, it is indeed very important that both aspects, that of course the Global Judicial Institute is independent in managing the networking element and other elements of the portal. And at the same time, it's very important for us to still mention that the value of this portal, which is the jurisprudence collection and many and the capacity building section for the non, so for the non-members, for the public at large, is of course where the interests of UNEP and the Global Judicial Institute totally converge. And it's important to mention that what is on the Global Judicial Institute's judicial portal will go straight to Ecolex, will go straight into INFORMEA, will go straight to other tools that are servicing other stakeholders. And this is a very important asset and a very important value from the UNEP's point of view. And of course, vice versa, it also means that some of the assets that are developed under INFORMEA, like online courses or the support of the glossary and tagging support, are available to the portal. And that is how it all comes together, so that there is not the feeling that there are more and more portals developed. These portals that are servicing specific stakeholder groups are all linked in the background and build on each other's knowledge. What has happened since this first beta version was made available at the end of last year? Without any outreach, there were already over 50,000 people finding the judicial portal online. And the education of a recent review of the INFORMEA portal's project performance, there was also a small question to the audience whether they are familiar with the judicial portal. And those who said they are familiar have already, even though not all services are fully functional, and most importantly, the networking section is still being developed, they were already very they already considered the portal very useful. And so this gives us a great sense of anticipation as to where we will go. And as I proceed from here, we just wanted to show you how this pans out in reality, in terms of what does it mean that the tools are linked. And so this is the Global Judicial Portal as it is being launched today. I hope you are seeing the right screen, are you?
Yes, yes.
Okay, but I'm somehow missing the right one on my end. So let me give it one more try. No, it's probably. Okay, now I think I'm sharing the right screen. And if you go to from here to the e-learning section, because I will then let Peter show the main services, you already find the courses that are available through the resources section, which includes many materials that come from some of the other tools. And here you can jump right into e-learning courses. In this case, there is a course on climate litigation that has been made available just a few weeks ago. And all this information is available from the INFORMEA portal that, of course, encompasses many courses that could be interesting and relevant. And I also wanted to show that in the context of the glossary of the judicial portal, it is possible to then get further information on related treaties and related legislation from these linked tools, such as here, the Law and Environment Assistance Platform, which is the platform of the Montevideo Law, Montevideo 5 process, or here on the treaty text of the Kyoto Protocol, which you can access from the judicial portal, and how it relates to the SDGs, which are on the forefront of today's joint struggle for the environment. So with this very brief introduction, I will maybe hand over to Peter to show you the most key features of the judicial portal. And thank you so much for your continued collaboration. Once again, specifically to Judge Clément and Judge Lavrysen, and of course, Judge Benjamin for this excellent collaboration. Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. So now the floor is to Peter.
Thanks, Justice Lavrysen, and thanks, Eva, for introducing the background, and Justice Benjamin. And thanks for the opportunity to present a bit in more detail the portal today. We're very excited to see the fruition of this number of years of collaboration in this official launch and to see where it grows from here. So I would go into a bit more detail of the functionality of the platform and maybe illustrate a bit what Eva's already introduced in terms of linking platforms, interoperability, digitization, how that actually works and function in this platform where the main architecture is now there and ready to be used. So the portal can roughly be divided into three main sections. The real backbone of the portal is, of course, the Library of Jurisprudence. In contrast to these other portals, which it interacts with, that focus on legislation or on MEAs or on treaty decisions, the real focus, of course, of this portal is on case law on jurisprudence. So this takes the form of both the library that's publicly available, but also importantly, the digital architecture to be able to collect cases from users of the platform. So the first is the jurisprudence library, basically. The second component, which was introduced or mentioned by Justice Antonio Benjamin, is also very important to the collaboration between GGIE and UNEP, is the judicial network. So this is a space specifically for GGI members and GGI judges to be able to discuss and network and find each other. So it consists of a directory and of a forum. And lastly, the resources section, which Eva touched on, which is basically the library of information, of video lectures, of reports, of whatever content that's sort of a space specifically for GGIE to be able to find and host these resources. So I would start then with the jurisprudence section. So I started specifically logged out to show that the portal is a bit split between the public facing section and certain elements that are specifically for people who are authenticated to either be able to contribute content or additionally to be able to contribute content as well as access this networking section. So if I want to browse jurisprudence, of course, that's publicly available from anyone who accesses the site. If I want to submit just to show you, then it of course prompts me to be able to log in. So then to be able to create an account, this would go to us, to the content managers, to be able to authenticate that user. So the idea was, of course, for judges and members of the judicial network to be able to share their cases, but additionally, other contributors, potentially prosecutors, partners of UNEP with UNEP projects, with GJA projects, regional UNEP staff members, whatever the case may be, so that it really is a tool that has a broad reach to be able to collect and start populating jurisprudence. Then additionally, if you try to go to the judicial network, you're specifically given a prompt where you need to be a member of the Global Judicial Institute, and then you can go to create an account that also goes to this validation section, where if you do say that you are a judge, there are some additional fields that need to be filled out. And one last word in terms of the process of this and the pipeline of it, both cases as well as users then go to the second step of authentication. So there's a bit of a workflow behind the scenes where the structure of the site is set up to be able to validate the people, validate the cases that come in. So there's a quality control built in. So then if I go now to start with submit jurisprudence and log in, I'll show you some of the fields that hopefully concretize a bit what we mean by the linking between these platforms and the utility of housing all of this process within one platform and making it internal and digitized. So things like, so if I do this test case, so the case I already know is there. Functions like showing you that there's already a duplicate. So you can see that perhaps someone's already added it or it's a related case that you can link to. So then there's a certain minimum set of fields, of course. And then this is another very interesting thing to show. If I add the PDF file, so this is just the PDF of the decision of actually a UN body decision. But then I'll go down to this, which is a very interesting thing, which works live now, where it can actually extract tags from the glossary, which is really the value add, another value add of having within this digital platform. It'll actually scan the PDF and give you suggestions from the glossary. So if you're not super familiar with the glossary yourself, it can already give you some suggestions, but you know the case, you can say, yes, climate change, that's right. Yes, admissibility, that's right. Civil procedure, that's not really right. Property, that's not really right. So of course it's not perfect, but it already gives you, and myself knowing the case, it's actually fairly good, this individual tagging. In addition, you can add some text to the key environmental legal questions or abstract, and it would also scan these fields to be able to give you some tags. And then finally, in terms of some of those many different fields, it can give you specific hints so that the users understand what we mean by these individual fields. Then at the very end, to demonstrate how this is linked to the other platforms. So if it's specifically about UNFCCC, let's say, then it will automatically pop up. This creates a link with a unique identifier where the system knows that this is specifically linked to the record on INFORMEA of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Same for court decisions within the portal. So this is based on a previous Supreme Court quick case from New Zealand, and I can click this to show that it's linked, and that creates a specific identifier in the back end. It kind of removes the human error if you type the case wrong, and it captures this information a bit better. And then lastly, the idea is, of course, that this then gets imported to the related platforms. So we're not recreating content types on each platform, where Ecolex and Leap are already generating legislation. INFORMEA already has these connections for MEAs. Then the jurisprudence would come from here, and we hope that judges can still opt out, but in most cases, then it would naturally or automatically be forwarded to these additional platforms. Just quickly then, to see what the front end looks like, the publicly available side of jurisprudence. You have, so these, of course, the tags, then you can see over here. So then if you select climate change, but then you can further narrow by this legal specific glossary. So then if you want to more specifically about climate change evidence, it narrows down to these two cases. If you select one case, this is the one that's already added. You can see how these tags are reflected and all the additional linked material. Quickly, I would introduce then the network as well. So Judge Clément and Justice Lavrysen were kind enough to create example profiles already, just to show this is what the directory would look like. Of course, it's not useful with just two judges. But if you have a volume of judges, you can filter by the specific type of law that they've indicated they're interested in, as well as the name. And then just to show you quickly what a profile looks like, you can have a little bit of an excerpt of your biography, link to either decisions, but hopefully decisions would be entered. And you can see here actually one of all the jurisprudence that that user has uploaded. The second aspect of the network is the discussions page. So this is basically a forum. It's three levels. The first level is basically the very broad topics. So right now, just for example, so we call them forums. I've created a broad forum of human rights, everything human rights in the environment. Within that, you can have topics. These topics can be added by any judge user. So I've created one, human rights and climate change. Within that topic, you can ask specific questions. And so besides this case that we were just looking at, are there other cases brought on the right to life? And then you can have a back and forth basically discussion over here. So fairly light touch forum, but it's there, and it's basically available to these authenticated judge/GGI users. The glossary we've already a little bit been over, but then the advantage of the same set of cases being on both INFORMEA and on the judicial portal. On judicial portal, it's the same set of cases largely, except it's tagged against this legal litigation specific or adjudication specific glossary. Whereas on INFORMEA, it would be tagged to this more MEA specific everything environment glossary. And you've already showed you a specific glossary page. And then finally, just rounding out, we mentioned e-learning. So these then connect to the INFORMEA portal. So these are what we think are more specifically interesting courses for judges. But you could also create specific e-learning courses that are only available on the judicial portal, not on INFORMEA, but still using the learning management system and architecture that we already have in place there. This is another way to navigate the courses that are in INFORMEA, We have a space here for video lectures, because I think there are a lot of those within GGI members that often give addresses that are recorded that could be useful to store in one place, and then other e-learning platforms where we want to link to other platforms that are doing much of the same work. We have training materials, which is basically just PDFs, a lot of UNEP materials, but it's open to anything UNEP and GGIE, or even just relevant to the judiciary. Similar, but reports, not specifically on, not as specifically on capacity building or training. Partners, just to point to platforms that are doing similar work that we don't want to replicate, where GGIE and the portal is specifically for these GGIE members and material. University still needs to be populated, but it's in place there. And finally, legislation, pointing to these tools that are more engineered specifically to navigate legislation, which already exists, which are already connected. It's the same body of legislation, but again, not to reinvent the wheel, where if your entry point is legislation, it's better to start from those tools. So thank you very much for the opportunity to present, and I'll hand it back to Justice Lavrysen. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Peter. And let's turn now to Marc Clément for his intervention. Please, Marc, you have
yes. the floor. Yes, thanks. Can you hear me? Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. So thanks a lot for the invitation. And this is really great to be part of this big event, and especially the launch of this official launch of this portal. I don't want to be too long, but I want to stress three points why and indicating why is it so important to share case law and jurisprudence for judges, and also to progress in networking in the domain of environmental law. First of all, and I won't be long because this is probably obvious for everyone, that there is an international dimension of environmental issues. Obviously, the planet is only one ecosystem and one thing that is to be protected everywhere. And also, and I think that's why UNEP is so useful in this context, there are many international conventions, and as judges, we are basically using the same legal body of text that is to be applied across the planet. We are facing common issues as judges. For instance, climate change is obviously one big common issue, but water pollution is to be tackled everywhere, air pollution as well. And so that means that per se, the exchanges between judges are very, very important. And that's also what we experience in the EU Forum of Judges for the Environment, where we had this annual conference where we compare the way judges are solving cases and very similar situation across Europe, seeing big differences, but also big similarities. Second point, which is very important, is sharing means for us, for judges, to find inspiration from other solutions. I just briefly give an indication from Europe, but we could probably find things similar like that everywhere. In climate change, we had, for instance, a very important Dutch Supreme Court Dutch case based on human rights applied in the domain of climate change. The German Constitutional Court issued also a very important case in climate change, but which is based on constitutional rights, and constitutional courts applied these constitutional rights moving in the same direction as the Dutch court, but using different reasoning. And the French Conseil d'Etat was also delivering a very important case on the basis of European directive and national laws. But we know also about there are many cases in India in different countries related on to air pollution or protection of biodiversity, and so having a tool as it was presented by Peter, where you can identify easily for one sector a set of cases which is relevant to one area is very, very useful. And I think that the brief presentation of Peter should be a way to be an incentive to go on the portal and to look at the different at the database and to find that we have many, many relevant case law which is already available and very interesting. And the last point I wanted to say is that the portal is a way for each jurisdiction to promote some of the cases, the landmark cases that have been decided in each jurisdiction. This promotion is very important. We all know that some judgments are known by many people in the world, such as, for instance, the Dutch case I mentioned on climate change, due to the fact that academics will comment these judgment very extensively. But there are other and many interesting judgments and cases that are not covered by these academics discussions. And I think it's a pity that we only focus on very specific countries. And I think that for the tool that is provided with the Global Institute Judicial Portal is a tool that will allow every country to promote some interesting cases for the benefit of everyone. I see that if you look at the database as it is today, you will find a lot of cases from India, a lot of cases from Tanzania, and this is very, very useful to have this global perspective. The Global Judicial Institute is a global institute, and it is not aimed at promoting specific case law from specific areas of the world. And I think that the last message I wanted to share is that there is a need specifically for Supreme Courts in every country to really find a way to provide cases to the judicial portal. But this is something that is not too complicated to do. As Peter has shown, this could be done quite easily. And I think each Supreme Court, or possibly each court, but I think if the momentum is given by Supreme Courts in every country, I think this is a very positive thing for everyone. And I really encourage everyone to share as much as possible what has been decided in every country. That will be very useful for every judge in the world. So thanks a lot for listening. And that was my brief intervention on that.
Thank you very, very much, Marc Clément. I don't know if the co-chair, meanwhile, managed to be online, Donald Kaniaru. He was not online at the beginning, I think, but I don't know if he's, meanwhile, has managed to join or not.
Yes, Donald Kaniaru is here in Stockholm.
Ah, he's in Stockholm. Okay. So I hand over now Donald for his final remarks. Donald Kaniaru, he joined UNEP shortly after headquarters was based in Nairobi, and he was involved with different, he performed different functions, including that of the director of the Division of Environmental Policy Implementation and much more. And after his retirement, he is still very active in bodies like the World Commission on Environmental Law, the International Council of Environmental Lawyers. So, Donald, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, my co-chair. He has been with me on this road of sensitizing each other, understanding each other for a long time, and it's a pleasure to take the forum together. It's time for questions, comments from the floor on the presentation so ably presented by the speakers you heard, and of course you are in the spirit of bring ourselves together to inform each other, to know one another, and to move forward together. It's a long way we have come, by the way. It is amazing. And the fathers of that development are here. As we close the meeting later on, I'll make a few comments that bring you up to date with the process starting 1996 and the first global judges symposium in 2002 in Johannesburg. For me, it is rewarding that in 20 years, these 20 years, you are on your 20th year, you are now mature. You know, over 18, you are now free agents in this particular area. So it is rewarding to see a number of those that were there at the beginning. I have here Antonio, whom you all know. I see Chief Judge of the Land and Environment Court that pioneered this process in 1979. And is still going strong. And of course, I do remember the struggles we had with the United States to begin with. My friend Scott Fulton there and Professor Dan McGraw would remember. And of course, even in our own countries, we had people who were saying, no, you don't understand. Judges know the law. They know it all. So why do you be saying you are training judges? Said, no, we are not training judges. We called it symposium, we called it colloquia. And from then now, you are actually running with a subject that was so at that time. Nobody had studied it. We were not sure where it was going. But now we are up and running with it. So, comments from the floor?
So very briefly, before we have questions and comments on the portal, there is still a lot to do in terms of refining the portal, but it's also relevant to recognize the work that has been done. It's amazing. So congratulations to the colleagues, both on the UNEP side and on the Global Judicial Institute on the environment side. I would like to thank in particular the colleagues from the board that have been participating since the inception of the idea. First of all, as I already mentioned, Luc Lavrysen and Marc Clément directly involved, Rangil Noe, Michael Wilson, Brian Preston, and Mansour Ali Shah, that we will be arriving at any moment, and Ricardo Lorenzetti that spoke yesterday. So now we are hoping to expand the conversation as we move to the more sensitive part of the portal, or the design and the implementation, which is the segment that will be open only for us judges, our space. And from the UNEP side, I would like to thank Inga Anderson, who has been very supportive, as I mentioned yesterday, of the Institute since the moment she was still director of IUCN. Elizabeth Merema, who was then the director of the law division, and Donald keeps telling me and Elizabeth that he hired her. So he selected Elizabeth. I will not say when this happened, but it was quite some time ago. Then in the division itself, Arnold Kreihuber, great supporter. Andrew Rain, I suppose Andy is connected with us. He'll be speaking at the closing. More recently, Patricia Mboti, she was here yesterday, and great supporter, very enthusiastic about the portal, and the wonderful team of two, Eva and Peter. And originally it was Eva. So Eva, we would like to thank you and this large team for putting together such a magnificent product. This is really the cutting edge of what, as Donald said, of what we have been looking for and thinking that it will be possible, and now it is possible. So Nick, I think there will be comments.
Yes, thank you. We have time for just 1 or 2 minutes of comments or questions if anyone has any questions they would like to raise. Right. Please, Justice Preston.
A question for Eva and Peter. With the uploading of the judgments, it's really important, as a number of speakers said, to have representative judgments from all over the world, all jurisdictions, all languages. The only problem is, and I suppose this is particularly for somebody like myself, who is not multilingual, we find difficulty in accessing the judgments if they're not in one of the well-known languages. Now, sometimes courts have been really good in producing an unofficial English version of the judgment. So in, for example, the agenda case, they did that. Also in the Norwegian Greenpeace case, they did that as well. So my question is, could both versions be uplifted to the portal so that people who are not fluent in Dutch or Norwegian, for example, are able to read the unofficial translation? And the second would be, could there be any flagging of a translation of some of the more important cases which could be uploaded? So if the court hasn't done that, somebody could do it, because otherwise a lot of us will miss out on all those words of wisdom that are in other judgments. So that's just a question. Thank you.
I will ask just one additional question that perhaps can be responded together with these matters from a questioner online, Maria Diane Rowland, who asks whether there is any possibility for creating an account in the judicial portal for non-judges or non-lawyers. Is that envisioned? Do you create an account for someone else who is interested in doing research on these matters? Or how does this work for a non-judge who's interested in looking at the information on the portal? Yeah, please.
Maybe coming back to the question of Brian Preston, I think more and more there are some automatic translation programs of which the quality is becoming better and better. And maybe we can consider if such a tool would be helpful to have access to other languages. But the second question, I'm more reluctant, but I'm giving the floor on that to Justice Antonio Herman Benjamin.
Well, I would like to hear from both Eva and Peter, but just on the question that came from a virtual participant, the portal, as the name indicates, is a judicial portal. But early on, we agreed that part of it could be open to the public, because it's also in our interest as judges that the public, and especially researchers and those that are experts in the subject, know what's going on in different jurisdictions globally. But the DNA is a portal by judges, for judges, in cooperation with UNEP. So we don't envision portal accounts for others than the judges. The open part of the portal is open to everyone. You don't need to have an account. But the part that is just for the judges, and that's the core of the portal for us from our perspective, in that one, only judges and sitting judges, not even retired judges, will have an account.
Yeah, are any additional comments from Eva or Peter on those issues?
Maybe just yes to come in here to say that, of course, even in UNEP, we are struggling because the translation into English, or at least even the summary in English of a case, is already a high level task for which you have to have a high level of understanding. And that is why it is very crucial that we have a number of vetted contributors, often universities, because judges tend not to have the time to do this work. So there is probably the option to have a contributing role through an institution with a vetting role of the Global Judicial Institute. And I think we would find a solution that would suit all of these. And I wanted to say on the tagging, the system is multilingual. So the five UN languages are possible to pick up the issues in the five UN languages. But of course, as soon as it's a non-UN language case, we are depending on the summary that comes with the case. So this is just a small practical intervention.
Thank you. We have time for just one more question. Justice Wilson, please.
Thanks, Nick. And thanks very much, Eva and Peter. I just wanted to be clear about the relationship, if any, with the established databases for legal research, such as Westlaw. It's my understanding that the judges are being asked to do the analysis of those cases that are of significance, and that that would mean the judges are the source of information and the analysis of, for example, which cases from Westlaw should be included. Is that correct? Maybe that was a hard one.
Maybe I can respond to the question. So, of course, this is an open source database. So it's not possible, I think, to copy or whatsoever jurisprudence from more commercial databases. And we can harvest on the basis of databases of the courts themselves and so on. But I think it's impossible to import or whatsoever any material from commercial databases where you have to pay for.
Yeah, if I may compliment, because this question was raised early on, even before we approach UNEP. As we know, in many countries, there are commercial data banks. And Mike mentioned Westlaw, which is probably the largest in the world and is operating not just in the United States anymore. So there was the suggestion from colleagues that once we have the portal fully operational, including the part that will be open and accessible only for judges, to contact Westlaw and other companies of that type and see whether the judges, that are members of the Institute could have free access via the portal to the data bank of Westlaw, but not importing Westlaw cases into our data bank. So that's still pending because we need to finalize the part of the portal that is just for judges.
Well, thank you all very much for those questions. And I'm sure there are many more questions about the operation of the portal. So I imagine that colleagues at the UN Environment Program would be willing to be contacted by email or otherwise with additional questions that you have. So in the interest of time, I think we'll need to close in order to move on to our next panel. But I'd like us to all give a round of applause to our chairs and panelists for this presentation.